Well, so selling to people who actually want to hear from you is more effective than interrupting strangers who don't. I say that again, selling to people who actually want to hear from you is more effective than interrupting strangers who don't. Listen, I don't know how many times as a business person, you probably think everyone that passes by your business is willing to buy what you're selling. Sometimes some people are minding their business and you think they are interested in your business. We'll be talking about how important it is for you to customer segment and know who exactly you are targeting with the different products that you are selling. And of course, if some things are not working, then you probably have to start thinking of, do we have experts in the business to caution them, or we see what next. If it's closing, hard as it may sound, sometimes it's just the right thing to do as a business person. Welcome to the Business Show. My name is Simon. This is what's coming up on the show this week.
I was working in one of the prominent hospitals in Uganda, and I resigned and started poultry farming. Why? My passion has always been farming.
Once again, welcome to the show. And the week had so much, including the whole conversation of the pipeline down here in Kampala. Of course, different technocrats in the sector from across the region were here, and the debate was entirely just on how they can actualize the pipeline, you know, construction to have the whole conversation of the refinery, you know, sorted after the recent launch by the president. We can hope that this can, you know, move away from the whole paper conversation to actualizing them, and the region sees this whole long-term waited for, you know, project that we hope will change so much about the well-being of the different citizens in the region. This week though, we'll start with Uganda's digital landscape, and we're talking just what are some of the hindrances that are slowing Uganda's move to the digital economy. And I know for a fact that there are probably some initiatives that are being put in place. Of course, we know there are platforms that are currently trying to move this whole digital economy conversation. However, the challenge has been, do Ugandans think it's the right time? And if not, what can be done with the mindset of those who still think cash is the way to go and we are not ready to dump it? Because I don't know on how many times you've told someone you want to pay them using your phone and they think, no, it's going to be, you know, kind of like some fraud stuff. So they feel, I need the actual cash. This week on Views from the Top, I speak to the digital economy lead, Saul Wakama from Innovation Village, who shares with us some of the things they are doing on how to help push Uganda's digital landscape. Plus, he also tells us how they can actually tackle the hindrances that are currently still available along the way. This is Views from the Top.
Thanks, Aloysius. My name is Saul Wakama. I lead the Digital Economy Practice Department at the Innovation Village. The digital landscape in Uganda is mostly tied to internet penetration and also the tools we use to access internet. So as far as internet penetration, I think it's at about 33%. That might not mean a lot, you know, but in terms of quantifiable numbers, we have about 33 million phones. Of those, we have about 10 million devices that are internet, smart devices, smartphones, tablets, and so on. So I think that kind of gives an idea as far as internet penetration in Uganda. The challenges are multifold. First and foremost, of course, is penetration, infrastructure. Digital access normally rides on the backbone of infrastructure, GSM network, internet. There's been so many concerted efforts successfully from government and private players like the MNOs, the telecoms, to extend the grid countrywide. But there's still gaps So the cost of infrastructure, just getting it to that last mile person. There's also just literacy around usage of devices, usage of technology. That also presents barriers to accessing digital services. There's also culturally, there are some communities that are almost traditionally excluded from accessing digital services. There are communities where elders, you know, just they're averse to technology. This is a barrier that we can address using sensitization. There are also cost of devices. The cheapest smart gadget to access the internet, I think, is about 120,000 shillings when new. And also, you know, to get it registered or to get a phone registered, there's some barriers to entry to accessing devices that can give you a means to digital services. So those are some of the key challenges that we have. The digital economy program, which I lead at the village, we're trying to find ways to solution for some of these challenges in society. And we use partnerships. If you look at the pillars of the program itself, number one is infrastructure. We feel shared infrastructure will help address the cost of infrastructure, because when you have people who are designing solutions, they need infrastructure, and a lot of times it's expensive. The second one is partnerships, because it's not something that a program can do by itself. We need to partner with policymakers. We need to partner with the people in excluded communities themselves. We need to understand what is it that we need to solution for them. We need to work with apex bodies. Some of our partners are apex bodies like the Farmers Federation, SME Federation, to help us design or to understand, to give a voice to those people. These are the apex bodies speak for those communities. So we're saying, as a digital economy program, what are the digital transformation aspirations of those communities? How can we work together? On our side as Innovation Village, we're technologists. We are also what we call ecosystem conveners. We bring together different players to solution for some of the challenges in the country. You know, how do we, together with these, extend technology to the last mile? How do we support to create jobs for young people who are very technologically savvy as long as you expose them to the technology? So that's what the role the digital economy program plays. We want to be to catalyze solutioning for some of these challenges. Like I said, we work through partnerships. So we would like to have, we have categories of partners that we work with. We have technology solution partners. These are mostly, you know, technologists who are creating solutions. You have startup companies, you have companies that already have services in the market that have been validated. And what we are saying, let us partner together. Let us support you to extend your services countrywide. So those are solution providers who are creating solutions that can be extended to the last mile using maybe an app. Traditionally, if say it's too expensive to get your app extended maybe to rural areas, we say let us work with you, because that's what our platform does. We also have channel partners, big, like I mentioned, the Farmers Federation, who have members, they convene members who we can discuss with what are the challenges you're facing that technology can address. And then we bring the solution developers and we, in the room, and it's okay, we have this challenge, let us address it this way using technology. So those are opportunities, but also we have skilling opportunities for young people who need to be reskilled or upskilled to take on the challenges of rapidly digitizing world. Some of those are some of the opportunities. Along the way, we work with policymakers, opportunities. Let us do the hard work to draft, to speak to these people and bring that to the people who make the policies. So there are multitude, but most importantly, let us partner. So we have information on our website, which is de.innovationvillage.co.ug. there's an application form, simple questions, please tell us what you're doing. Let us start solutioning.
How can individuals really participate or collaborate in this program?
That's very important also. Individuals are the, you know, the last mile beneficiary. We're looking to, you know, impact, positively impact youthful youth mostly in the country, and as individuals, of course, their voice is very, very big. What we need is for them to understand the program, and we interface with them where they are. We want them to be evangelists for the program. For them to do that, first of all, we have to message correctly to them. What is it about? What is digital transformation? Then understand what are their digital transformation aspirations, what are their business aspirations, so that they can be ambassadors in their communities as individuals. Similarly, the stakeholders I mentioned, the partners we work with, as individuals in their communities, in their ecosystem, they can be evangelists for digital transformation. Not only that, they can also they have ideas. What are the challenges? What are we not seeing? Because we're out there, we're asking, we're consulting. Please help us co-design solutions for the challenges of Uganda around the youth, around unemployment, around lack of digital transformation. Right now, most of the digital transformation is driven by government. We are saying, okay, let's put a phone in someone's hand. But if that's not the solution, there has to be other solutions. Let us think about those. We call it hacking the last mile. Ideas of that nature will come from the individuals who understand the program, who are curious about it, and who are willing to co-design solutions.
So the mindset aspect is definitely strong. Then you talk about some of us are not connected. There's that whole conversation of some of us are not connected. How can we transact without handling cash? I can tell you one thing for sure. On any given day, if you cannot access your bank, but you have to make transactions, just imagine you have money and on your phone, and there's so much that you have to clear. And somehow you do this without physically meeting the person you're sending money to or handing over cash in person. These are some of the things we're trying to talk about, digital economy. And maybe, I don't know, maybe 5-10 years, it could be something that we might get into and try to see if it's possible to ensure that even the last person in the village can transact without handling cash. It is something that, whereas it, for you or any other person, it could seem tricky, it only eases operations for you because you save on time, but also, you know, the costs are there, but not as much as if you were to board to go to the other person and give them the cash. The risks and all that is what is sometimes avoided with the cashless economy. Okay, conversation done. Time for a quick break on the program with Ms. Simon. Now, when I get back, I'll be telling you more about how to make money. In the meantime, feel free to get in touch with us. Drop us those comments on our socials right below your screen. Tell us where you're watching from. Also, if you feel there's something you want to learn about the program or the previous programs, we are here at the Vision Group headquarters in Kampala. I'll be more than glad to help you. I'll see you shortly. Stay with us.